the game. Me, Tayshaun. I mean, me, Rasheed. We should have five. Me, Rasheed Wallace, Ben Wallace, and Chauncey Billups.
Wow, four.
Four at that time. So that was an exciting time for us. It was exciting. Time for the city of Detroit, because it just lets you know that, hey, basketball is not an individual sport, and you want to get the glory with your guys, with your teammates, and I always felt as though my game benefit playing with them guys. So to get an opportunity to play in an all-star game with three incredible all-stars was just one of the most amazing things for my whole entire basketball career.
Yeah. You, Zig, did it 12 different times and played alongside so many what would become future Hall of Famers. Is there any one thing that stands out about All-Star Weekend?
Always, when you got there, the camaraderie that you had, and Magic and I would always, you know, we would either go to dinner, go to the movies, or just try to get away a little bit just to get some rest. But I remember my first All-Star game in New Jersey, Brendan Byrne Arena, and I remember I got fouled, and I went to the foul line, and that was the first time it, like, really hit me, like, I'm in the All-Star game, because I was bouncing the basketball, and I looked up at the free throw line, and there was Kareem, Dr. J, and I froze. I was like it was like an out of body experience, because I was like, damn, that's Kareem, and I shot an air ball.
My first
free throw ever was an air ball in New Jersey, Brendan.
Oh, wow.
Because I shot it and I was like, damn, that's Kareem. And I'm on the floor with him. I'm in the wrong place.
Well, how surreal to know that you, just right before that, would probably have paid money to be in the building just to see those guys. And now you're
trying
expected
to get the
shoot a free throw.
I was trying to get the autograph.
Me too. Yeah. I made sure that everybody signed my jersey.
Yep.
I made sure everybody signed all my sneakers, just to have that memory, that moment. Because, like you said, you grow up watching the All-Star game. I grew up watching you and Michael Jordan and Magic Johnson and all the great players that played before me. So once you're on that stage and you get an opportunity to see all the fans around you, sometimes you get a little too overexcited. I remember in a game that I was coming down and I was trying plays that I usually don't try in the game.
Yeah.
And Chauncey had to grab me. He said, hey, bro, you a throwback. Hey, you don't need to be out here trying all these double, triple crossover under your legs. Just play your game and go out there and have fun. So a lot of times it kind of gets the best out of you just from an excitement standpoint that you want to go out there and put on a show.
Yeah.
We do have some news, though, elsewhere in the NBA. As earlier Friday, first reported by Adrian Wojnarowski, that the Pelicans and GM Del Demps have now parted ways. This guy's, of course, in the wake of Anthony Davis's request to be traded and then the following. Can we call it a process between the Pelicans and Lakers?
It's an ongoing process that we know where it's probably going to end up with Davis being in L.A. Yeah. I mean, that's where he wants to go.
Was that ultimately the right move for the Pelicans to make?
Which one?
The reported trade offer from the Lakers, which included multiple players, multiple picks for Anthony Davis now, prior to the trade deadline.
You know, I look when you look back and you hear everything, I thought the Lakers package in terms of the players that they put out there with the draft picks, I thought it was a good deal for the Pelicans at that time. Davis had gone on record saying he didn't want to be there. And not only did he go on record saying he didn't want to be there, but he's also said publicly that anyone who trades for him, right, it's a one-year rental, because he's made up his mind he wants to play for the Los Angeles Lakers. And he's got 1 year to wait to do that. Now, when a player is that determined, that focused, that committed, then, you know, the gig is up. He's going there. Now you have to try to make the best deal that you possibly can. I think what New Orleans did from a management standpoint, they waited, and then the earth shifted, so to speak. And when the earth shifted, so to speak, you're looking at a Boston team now that they're not sure if Kyrie's there or not. You're looking at that trade scenario that may come or may not. It's a lot of maybes out there, but I thought the bird in the hand that they had with the Lakers, that it was a good deal.
Where then does the team go from here? Because very likely that was the best offer they were going to get for Anthony Davis, because the Lakers, if they make another offer, it's not going to be for as much, knowing that a year from now he's going to be a Laker anyway as a free agent, and anywhere else is going to see this, as you mentioned, Isaiah, a one-year rental. So why give up the entirety of your bench?
Well, I thought, like Zeke said, I thought that the Pelicans should have made that deal then, because when you get three, you know, guys that have a high ceiling, when you talk about Lonzo Ball and Kuzman and Brandon Ingram, two of them guys were lottery pick, and Kuzman should have been a lottery pick too. Yeah. So you're not going to get anything better than that unless you make a deal with Boston. But his father already came out and said that's not the place that he wants to be at. So I feel like that was one of the best deals that they can probably get when you're talking about assets from a team where you get three guys that can come in, play it right away, and you can get two picks.
Well, then let's take this from the other side then. If you're the Lakers, where do you go from here?
Oh, if you're the Lakers, you wait.
You wait, yeah.
I mean, the Lakers' game plan when Magic came in was to look at this summer in terms of free agency. They were lucky, and his first time up to bat, he hit a grand slam by grabbing LeBron James. I mean, no one in there, there's not a – if you polled the 30 GMs, right, every GM wanted LeBron James. Magic first bet up to the plate, he grabs LeBron James. And when LeBron James came, then the fury started of everybody, all roads going to L.A. Mm. Everybody wants to play there. And I still think there are some players that still want to play there, be with LeBron James, be with Magic, be with the Lakers, be with that organization, simply because they believe that Magic knows how to win and he's a proven winner.
AD, though, is not a free agent until next summer, so he's going to end up somewhere else for the coming season. If it's not the Lakers, though, do you get concerned at all about perhaps the window for LeBron James to lead a championship team slowly closing right in front of us as he takes another team yet on his back to try and make a playoff run?
His window is shrinking, and yes, we all know that. And I think Magic knows that. That's why I think they go out and try to get another once-in-a-lifetime, once-in-a-generation type player with Anthony Davis, because when LeBron does get slower out there, because that time will come. You know, it might be 5 years from now, because right now it doesn't look like he's slowing down at all. But then you got a guy like Anthony Davis that can kind of carry the torch. LeBron James loves to play that point forward position where he don't have to go out there and score. He wants to be a guy that kind of sets other guys up. And if you add Anthony Davis to the mix, you're going to get other vets that want to come to your ball club to win. That's what happened to LeBron in the past when he was in Miami. You got Ray Allen to come take less money to play with you. You got Shane Battier. You got players that actually fit what you want. So I just think that when you're looking at LeBron James' window, yeah, Magic knows that, hey, I got to go out and get another superstar because LeBron is not going to be playing at a high level for the next 10 years. If I get a guy like Anthony Davis and hopefully get some free agents to play around these two guys that want to win now and want to win a championship, I think they'll be in good shape.
And let me give you the other side of this. I'm Anthony Davis, right? LeBron's going to be gone in 2-3 years, and I'm the king of
LA. The king of LA, yes. Yes.
And I got Kuz, I got Ingram, I got Ball, I got a young crew to work with who's had some, you know, some experience and some growth. I still got my picks. And by the way, my cap is still clean. Yeah. I can go and grab another free agent. So when LeBron leaves, right, I'm still, what, 27, 28? And you the king of L.A. with the Lakers.
Yeah.
I mean, that ain't a bad spot.
And he wants to be in L.A. Everybody knows he wants to be
right
in L.A.
Just
that's the
house.
Thing.
So
it's going to work for him. At the end of the day, regardless if somebody does make that trade and rents him for a year, he's going to L.A. That's what it's set up to be, just like LeBron James. He wanted to be in L.A. for the last couple of years. Finally, he's there making his mark in the city.
Well, AD is going to be here this weekend. LeBron's going to be here this weekend. Let's get back to All-Star, as this is Game Time Live from Charlotte. The 68th annual NBA All-Star Game is coming up. We're 2 days away from that. And the head coach of the Milwaukee Bucks is going to be the head coach of Team Giannis, Mike Budenholzer. Our Roz Gold on Wood, I caught up with him earlier today.